Hi, I'm Douglas Mason, President and CEO of Magnum Gold Corp Inc., MGI on the TSX Venture Exchange. A 2015 drill program on the LH property intersected high-grade gold, including 16.9 meters of 13.58 grams and 11 meters of 20.66 grams per ton gold. A follow-up drill program is planned to further evaluate previously identified subsurface high-grade gold mineralization. Please visit our website at magnumgoldcorp.com.
Welcome to the Goddard Report. Comments made on the Goddard Report and TalkDigitalNetwork.com are an expression of opinion only. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Kris Sims, BC Director of the Canadian Taxpayers Federation. Welcome back to the show and a belated Happy Canada Day.
Oh, same to you. Thank you very much for having me on.
Lower Mainland people listening to the show will be glad to know that while they pay the highest gasoline prices in Canada, their mayors, members of the TransLink board, have decided that those prices aren't high enough. They're going to add another 1.5 cent per liter tax to help pay for transit. Are they already gouged when it comes to taxes?
People are just absolutely tapped out. I mean, the cost of living in the Lower Mainland is just eye-watering for most average people. So keep in mind, we pay the highest gasoline prices in all of North America. We have the highest auto insurance rates in the entire country. And housing, in most cases in Vancouver, costs more than Manhattan. So that requires people to drive and to commute and to use their vehicles for work. And it requires a lot of transportation, both for businesses, individuals, and goods, getting goods trucked to us. And the idea that they're going to gouge us even more at the pumps is just absolutely outrageous. Remember, years ago, we had a big referendum on a TransLink tax. They wanted to impose a sales tax in the Lower Mainland to give more money over to the gold-plated panel that is TransLink. And the people actually came out and voted no, a very strong no in that referendum. Fast forward until now, and the same politicians who were beat soundly in that referendum are often now in power in Victoria. And they're crowing about the fact that we've been stripped of our rights to have a referendum on transit spending in the Lower Mainland. And they've just told the Mayor's Council in Metro Vancouver that they now have the quote-unquote permission to raise taxes by 1.5%, which equates to 1.5 cents per liter. And frankly, people said no to this. They told TransLink to go find efficiencies. They told these politicians to stuff it. But guess what? They're just jacking up the cost anyway. But we do have a little bit of time to fight this. The mayors don't have to follow through on this. If they could actually get their acts together before next spring and find the funding somewhere else for TransLink, all of the other funding will still come into place. And keep in mind just how gross this is, because this is national funding, federal, and provincial funding, and local. So taxpayers from all three levels of government are getting hosed for billions of dollars for TransLink in this case. And they said no to it. And to have them ignored by the very politicians who seek their votes whenever it's convenient for them is really an affront to democracy. And so anybody listening who doesn't feel like paying more for gasoline taxes in the Lower Mainland and diesel taxes needs to pick up the phone and really needs to pay attention this coming fall to the municipal elections. They need to call these politicians who are running for councillors and mayors in the area and tell them that they will not get their vote if they're supporting jacked up gas taxes.
So, and essentially, they're ignoring the will of the voters.
They're absolutely ignoring the will of the voters. And people will often say, oh, well, there's a funding gap. If we start letting politicians and bureaucrats get away with that baloney narrative, we're just going to continue to pay more. It's very easy for some city planning bureaucrat or some politician to dream up some pie-in-the-sky project or idea, overextend, overpromise, and then say, oh, look, there's a funding gap. Guess who gets to come along and fill it? It's only ever the taxpayer. And the taxpayer is tapped out. More than 40% of our incomes go to various levels of government now. Like, a lot of people are really, really struggling. The latest stat I saw on housing costs in Metro Vancouver is just, it takes my breath away. It said that about 80% now of the average worker's cost of what they raise goes to housing. 80! Like, where's the rest of their money coming from for food and transportation and schooling or anything else? That's just 20% left over. Well, guess what? They're stacking on lines of credit on top of lines of credit. And the moment that those interest rates start going up, it's going to look like the early 80s all over again. So, like, these politicians really need to give their heads a shake and start bringing these prices down and bringing these taxes down. And as we pointed out during the referendum, this isn't a choice between no transit whatsoever and everybody needs to walk, or TransLink's gold-plated, you know, dreams that they come up with. If these politicians who love transit so much had just dedicated 0.5% of their future tax growth that they get from people moving into their regions and paying property taxes, it would have more than covered their municipal portion. That's a tiny fraction of the taxes they rake in every year. But they wouldn't put their money where their mouths are. They would rather spend every cent of it in their own jurisdictions rather than pony it up for transit. And they'd rather stick the bill with the motorist who drives from jurisdiction to jurisdiction and doesn't necessarily get to vote for them. It's a cheap way out of it.
What about city councilors? I remember Vancouver Council, I think it was last year, they were going to have a 7.9% hike in taxes, like that's the kind of pay raise you get a year. And Carrie Jang, one of the city councilors, said, no, I don't think that's enough. Add another 1%. Like, no study put into it or anything.
Well, of course, if you have a funnel into the vault of taxpayer money, what's to stop these people from just taking more and more of it? It's the same thing that we saw at Metro Vancouver a few weeks ago when they decided to vote themselves a retroactive retirement bonus and pay hike. And they tried to do it because they thought they could get away with it. It was only because a whistleblower actually contacted the media that alerted people to this and had people mad as hell and had them eventually back down. And that isn't over. You know, they've kicked this over to some study. And then after the election and everything's quieted down, they'll try to do it again, I'm sure. So we'll have to pay extra special care, probably around Christmas and New Year's or something. They'll probably try to put it out on a Friday afternoon like they did before. But frankly, if they can take money and get away with it, unfortunately, many of them often will. And there's too few politicians at every level of government now that thinks long and hard before spending taxpayers' money. If they would take the W.A.C. Bennett philosophical approach and say, I won't spend this money unless I absolutely have to, or would I be willing to walk up and down my street and knock on my neighbor's doors and ask directly for their money for this project? If it's truly needed, like clean water or healthcare or truly for textbooks and education, most people would willingly give that money. But if you think that you need to come up with some weird reason for it and they wouldn't give you that money, it's probably not worth doing and it's probably unethical.
Also, shouldn't governments have an office of efficiency? I know we have the Auditor General. They put out a great report every year for both the provincial and federal governments. What about municipalities? Shouldn't they have their own little office of efficiency? Is this money being well spent? Do we have to spend 10% of our budget on artworks for bizarre-looking things in the middle of roundabouts in quiet neighborhoods that nobody asked for?
Exactly, and that's a great point. There actually, up until just recently, is an office. Basically, it's a municipal auditor general, is what it's supposed to be. It was created a few years ago, but frankly, it's got no teeth. It's been horribly managed. They haven't really provided any sort of service. And it sounds like they're eventually just going to shut the office down or restart it in some new branding way or something. But we need the equivalent of the federal auditor general here in BC, and frankly across Canada, that deals with municipal governments. As we move further and further down the line of city-states, in a way, for lack of a better term, where municipalities, mega-municipalities like Metro Vancouver or the City of Calgary, dealing with so many things in our day-to-day lives, from taxation to transportation to freedom of movement, all of these things. The more we move along there, the more oversight we're going to need. And unfortunately, there's next to no oversight of any municipal council or politician. And that's why they try to get away with this stuff. Voter turnout is terrible for municipal elections. It usually hovers around, you know, 20%, between 20 and 30%. That's not enough. We need to get more people active and involved. But frankly, so many people are so busy and they're so tired and tapped out. They just actually don't have the time or energy to keep an eye on this stuff. And that is why, absolutely, we need a very healthy, well-trained watchdog for all municipalities in BC. And I hope that the provincial government means what they say when they say they want to revamp that office or start it from scratch, because it's absolutely needed.
We'll have more with Kris Sims right after the break.
MGX Minerals is revolutionizing the new energy economy with patented lithium extraction technology, replacing traditional solar evaporation using low-cost, low-energy nanofiltration. The first system of this paradigm shift technology is currently being commissioned. MGX Minerals trades on the CSE, symbol XMG, the OTCQB, symbol MGXMF, and Frankfurt, symbol 1MG. For more information, visit our website, mgxminerals.com.
I'm Kelly Jennings, CEO of PowerBand Solutions. PowerBand is a cloud-based provider of auction, inventory, and finance solutions that make buying, selling, and financing vehicles more efficient. PowerBand Solutions trades on the TSX Venture Exchange symbol PBX and on the OTCQB symbol PWWPF and on Frankfurt symbol 1ZV. For more information, please visit us at powerbandsolutions.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Kris Sims. Kris, Ottawa has decided that for the next 5 years, none of the Western provinces are going to get any transfer payments from the federal government, while Ontario gets billions, Quebec gets $11 billion. Is that fair, and should we stop paying federal taxes if we're not going to get any of the money back?
You know, this is something that has been plaguing a lot of Western Canadians for a long time, the unfairness of equalization payments. Now, on paper, equalization could be seen as a good thing. It's supposed to be giving to provinces who are down on their luck, who are having a hard time. So basically, that our access to care for things like healthcare, education, transportation, the basics of modern life in the Western world, that those basics are generally on an even keel, whether you're living in Nova Scotia, Alberta, or British Columbia. Now, we actually know that they aren't. You know, trying to find a family doctor in Nova Scotia, for example, is actually impossible. The way that they're funded there is just brutal. It's a very, very deeply depressed have-not province, and unfortunately it has been that way for a long time. I have experience from living there, and also a lot of my family still lives there. But they depend so much on that equalization funding that if you cut it off completely, I mean, it would just be a disaster for the province. But there needs to be a more fair formula, so that if provinces refuse to develop their natural resources, so for example, if they sit there and try to ban fracturing for natural gas, something that we've done in northern British Columbia and different parts of Alberta now for generations, safely, in order to provide good, clean energy for people. If they do stuff like that, if they start trying to ban offshore oil drilling that's done in a very careful manner, if they start blockading all lines of help, all lines of good, clean, economic industrialism, and still want handouts from Western provinces who do responsibly use their natural resources, like British Columbia, Alberta, and Saskatchewan, then there needs to be a mechanism to slowly start turning those taps off or to renegotiate them. It's the same thing as if, you know, if you're on employment insurance and you've been laid off through no fault of your own, that is what that net is for. It's to help you so that you can pay your rent and still buy food and buy your bus tickets. Like, that's absolutely essential and what it's there for. But imagine if you never needed to look for work again for 10 years, 15 years, and you were just willing to get by on that level of subsistence, and all you ever did was collect EI, employment insurance, without ever being employed again. How fair would that be to the other able-bodied working people around you? Well, of course, it wouldn't be fair. And so that's where there needs to be a correction, frankly, when it comes to equalization payments. And I think most everyday Canadians completely understand that line of thinking, that safety nets are there for a hand up and to eventually get you back on your feet, to get you retrained, to get you back in the workforce. And trust me, I've been there. It's terrible. Losing your job is terrible. And that's what the safety nets are for. And that's why Canada is a great country. We're compassionate and careful. But it can't be generational over and over again. And I think that's, frankly, why Western Canadians get so frustrated when they see things like this really inequitable equalization payments going to mostly eastern provinces.
We'll have more with Kris Sims right after this.
Baddock Ventures Corp. is a potash exploration company focused on the Korat Basin in Thailand, the world's largest undeveloped potash resource. Baddock's management has extensive potash exploration and development experience in Thailand. Baddock will have marketing advantage compared to Western producers. Drill program commences this spring. Baddock trades on the TSX Venture, symbol VCV, and on Frankfurt, symbol V8V2. Visit our website, baddockventures.com.
Don't miss out. Stay informed. Receive the HowStreet.com weekly recap with thought-provoking podcasts, radio, and articles delivered to your inbox. Sign up for the HowStreet.com weekly recap on our homepage at HowStreet.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Kris Sims. Kris, the government tells us that a record low number of people are collecting EI, and yet the premiums for it keep going up. That must mean they must have a horribly large surplus collecting. Why can't they either cut the premiums, which is an indirect tax on Canadians, or transfer some of that money to pay off or into the pension fund, which is underfunded?
That's a great question. We all remember way back in the previous Liberal administration where they raided the EI fund, as they called it. But that was meant, it's meant for people who, as we said, who need a safety net. You know, lots of people unfortunately get laid off, and that's literally there to help feed them and their families. But if it starts becoming this massive surplus, that means that, in essence, those employees and employers, both pay into it, are being overtaxed. And you're right. If they're having too much of a surplus going in there, they'll need a float. There always needs to be a float there, just in case there's some, God forbid, some big disaster in a mine shuts down or a factory shut down in the dozens, and you need to have that safety net there for a large number of workers. But if it starts getting way, way toppled over and too high, they should reduce the amount that you need to pay into it, because otherwise you are being overtaxed for something that you aren't using. So it's the same as one would hope other insurance works, that there's just enough there to cover capital costs and to cover rainy day funds and to cover disasters, things like that. But they're not overpricing you, and that's what needs to be done with it. As far as moving it over to other elements, that's something that we'd have to actually take a look at before commenting. But frankly, I think most people know that if they've got way too much left in the bank account for employment insurance to ever, ever pay for people who are unemployed, that it's too high and it's too much. And if they reduce those premiums, that's more money back in our pockets, and that's more money back in the pockets of employers, businesses, people who actually hire people, and then maybe they could hire even more people, or they could hire people on part-time, or they could bring on a new student. It's only ever a good thing if you reduce the costs of for employers and employees both. So it's definitely something they should look at.
Canada has over $40 billion in federal taxes that are uncollected. Their big problem, they don't have enough people to chase down these scoff laws. Shouldn't they hire enough to look after them?
That's a great question. I'm always worried, though, if we start hiring more people, either at Canadian Tax Revenue Agency or within the federal government, because I'm always worried about efficiency. So, frankly, they can't even pay their own people, their own legitimate employees, through a Phoenix payroll system, which is the software that was supposed to be used.
And shouldn't Phoenix be the ones paying to repair it, to make
think,
it work?
You know, it's so frustrating. Quite often, you know, bureaucrats, you know, it depends on how often they work. But there are some who do good work, and there are those who warned the incoming government, hey, we know Phoenix is supposed to be online as of like 18 months ago, but we've delayed it 6 months by 6 months now three times because it's not ready yet, sir. So there's always permanent government. There's bureaucrats that are there. They're within departments, doesn't matter what it is, foreign affairs, finance, etc. So in this case, the bureaucrats in that department warned the minister and said, Minister, this software is not ready yet. We know it's supposed to be implemented about 18 months ago, but it's not ready yet. So we're just asking you to delay it again by six more months, delay the implementation, because otherwise there's going to be a disaster. The minister, who was newly elected, said no. And they implemented it anyway, against the direction of the department. And look what's happened now. It's going to cost taxpayers more than $1 billion to fix. It's just a disaster. So when we start thinking about hiring more investigators with CRA, I do get a little bit nervous because I wonder where that money is actually going to go.
Well, why not contract it out where they get 15% of what they collect or 10% and have it done that way? Because private business would be a lot more efficient knowing they only get paid when they're successful.
That's innovative thinking. I've never thought about doing that for tax collection. Usually people do it when you need to, you know, get a car repoed or that shiny quad that you didn't have money to pay for. If we actually started doing that for federal taxes, that would make it much more interesting. It's something we'd have to study for sure.
And Kris, your favorite people are hanging out on a bridge in central Vancouver right now, the Iron Workers Memorial Bridge. Can you tell us about that and why you find it semi-humorous?
Oh, our favorite people at Greenpeace. Remember when they first started way back, I think it was late 70s, and they were literally putting their lives on the line to save whales? Well, now they've just gone so far that they will protest a country like Canada that has one of the best human rights records in the world, some of the strongest environmental regulations in the world, the oil sands, the way it actually functions. If people actually go and look how it actually functions, people would be amazed at how cleanly they can extract the oil, which is naturally present in the sand. That is why it's literally called oil sands. So now we've got Greenpeace hanging from the Iron Workers Memorial Bridge, from ropes, and those aren't made of hemp. My point here is we live in the modern world, in a modern age, mostly due to the miracle of hydrocarbons, mostly due to oil and gas and their derivatives, all the products that you can make from oil and gas, and frankly, all of the industries and transportation made possible by oil and gas. So here we have these protesters hanging from very sturdy industrial strength nylon braided ropes with their metal carboners hanging there from this bridge with their nylon windbreaker jackets, all covered in petroleum products. They're even using iPhones and cell phones, which of course rely on a lot of natural resources to make happen. The hypocriticalness of this is just astounding. These folks really need to stop themselves and think about who they're protesting and what they're protesting. If they truly want to live as one with nature and walk around and live only in the woods, that's up to them. Or honestly, if they want to go join like a commune that is similar to the Amish, only using horse and wagon, that is their freedom to do. But they don't. They take advantage of all the modern niceties of the world while protesting its lifeblood, which is oil and gas. I also find it very interesting they don't protest Saudi Arabia or Venezuela.
Or Mexico, which produces the same kind of oil as Alberta.
Right? And it's so interesting that here they are protesting, but there's so many tankers around the Netherlands, for example. If they went in the north coast of Europe, it's full of tanker traffic. Or if you go down to Washington State, it's full of tanker traffic, literally going the same route that these other tankers using Kinder Morgan would be taking. But they're not protesting them.
In Seattle, they have protests asking for pipelines because they don't want oil transported by oil or by rail.
And oil transported by rail is very dangerous, as we saw horribly in Quebec with Lac Mégantic. And here in the Fraser Valley, we see an oil pipeline go through every couple of hours or so. It just so happens to be segmented into dozens of black cars rolling along a railway along the Fraser River Canyon and the Fraser River Valley. This is a major problem. Kinder Morgan's pipeline has been running underground since the 1950s. The only visibility of it are little tiny yellow sticks that stick up out of the ground. This has been functioning safely and well now for more than a generation. And so that's where you really need to start questioning these people. And the main thing we need to look at, too, is where their funding is coming from. Quite often, if you keep scratching below the surface, a lot of these protesters are very well paid, often by American-funded protest groups, including the Rockefeller Group, and Rockefeller started Standard Oil.
Kris, thanks a lot for being on the show.
Thank you, as always, for caring about these really important topics.
And Kris, is there a website people can go to find out more information about the Taxpayers Federation?
Absolutely. You can find years worth of research and studies and reports and some pretty funny videos at taxpayer.com.
Thanks again, Kris.
Thank you.
My guest has been Kris Sims, BC Director of the Canadian Taxpayers Federation. You're listening to the Goddard Report on talkdigitalnetwork.com. Find us on Twitter at TalkDigitalNet. Our YouTube channel is Talk Digital Network. Questions for the show or our guests, like Kris, can be emailed to info@howstreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard. Thanks for listening.
Comments made on the Goddard Report and TalkDigitalNetwork.com are an expression of opinion only. The Goddard Report is available online and mobile at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. The Goddard Report is a production of How Street Media Incorporated.